Good morning. We're glad you joined us here online and in the church, in God's house, particularly on such a beautiful and brisk Sunday morning. This is truly the type of day that the Lord has made. Let us rejoice and be glad in it. And now let us prepare ourselves for worship. Are you doing the prelude? Okay. Instead of bells, it's going to be Lavella and the piano.
This morning I'm going to call for the Spirit of God to descend upon our hearts. It was one of my father's favorite songs, and I never understood as a young child. I thought it was boring. But it is so poetic. So if you want to follow along on the words, you can go in your hymnal to page 265 and follow the words as we call for the Spirit of God to descend upon us today.
Thank you.
Thank you, Lavella. We're very blessed to have such talented musicians as part of our church that can step up at the last minute and fill in. Will you join me in the call to worship that's printed in the bulletin? A new world awaits. Welcome to in the house of God. Find hope and blessing. A new world awaits. Sing praise to God who beckons us to dwell in the new community of the redeemed. And now, if you will, stand if you are able, and let us join together in singing our opening hymn, Alleluia, Sing to Jesus, number 233. We'll sing all verses. Thank you for bringing us together again this morning in your house and on the internet. We're thankful for the many blessings you've given us and continue to give us each day. Yet this morning we also come to you with apprehension and concern for the troubles in the world around us. We know that you love us so much that you established a special covenant with us through the death and resurrection of your Son, Jesus. And yet it seems we forget that, and we stray from your pathway all too often. We look to ourselves rather than trusting you in all we do. We tend to look inward to ourselves and to our needs rather than the needs of others. We long for peace, but many innocent people are caught up in the midst of wars, and we ask that you watch over them and sustain them through these difficult times. We ask that you guide the leaders of all nations to strive for and find ways to peaceful settlements that will heal the wounds of divisiveness that tear and push nations and people apart. Bring us together again in harmony. Help us to care for each other as brothers and sisters, as your children. Father, as we gather in your house this morning, restore our souls and recharge our lives to your service. Grant us the wisdom to recognize those who may need our help or comfort, and grant us the strength and willingness to provide it. Help us to stand firm in our faith and to trust you in everything we do as we pray the prayer that Jesus taught us. Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our debts as we forgive our debtors. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, and the power, and the glory forever. Amen. If you will look in your bulletin on the inside page, there's a list of the activities here in Countryside, including the quilters, Bible study, bell and choir practice, and the American Heritage Girl Scouts. There's also a note that the men's coffee group will be meeting Tuesday at Ronnie's at 9 a.m. And Linda Sell has a couple of announcements for the women's group. Because I spent 4 hours yesterday upgrading our class director from Shawnee Mission North of 59.
I have two announcements. I'll try not to yell or touch it. I'm sorry. I'd like to remind you of the invitation that has been offered to you by the Disciples Women to join us on a day trip to Tall Oaks Camp and Conference Center on a Thursday, May 16th. We'll leave the church at 10 o'clock in the morning and try to be back sometime between 3 and 4. But the $15 fee includes a luncheon and a hayride, and we will close our day at Tall Oaks with a worship service at their beautiful chapel. So I hope you will either talk to Susie Arnold or me and tell us your plans to join us on that day. And the second announcement I have is that next week and on First Friday in May, the Disciples Women will be raffling a baby-themed wreath that Debbie Renner has made and donated to us to raise funds for the scholarship efforts. So thank you very much.
And there's one other announcement about the Greater Kansas City Disciples Women's Ministry Regional Evening Meeting is April 25th at 6:30 at the Miriam Christian Church. There'll be an information packet will be up in the office. Tomorrow is the last day for registration, so if you want to go, make sure that you get your registration into the office by that time. Are there any other announcements that we need to make this morning? If not, then let's go to our prayer song, My Shepherd, You Supply My Need, number 80. We'll sing verses 1 and 3.
As we come to our prayer time this morning, most of you have noticed that Gabe is not here with us this morning. I got a couple of phone calls from him yesterday, though nobody was on the other end, and then I called him back and he didn't answer, and finally I said, hope everything's okay, send me a text. He sent me a text telling me that he was in the hospital at Advent. I talked with him this morning on the way to church. He called. He had a little fainting spell yesterday. He said he gradually fainted. It wasn't like all at once just out. It kind of came on gradually. And so Patty called the paramedics. They came and took him to Advent Hospital, and they insisted on keeping him for observation overnight. He told me that unless they find something in the test that they are running today, that he will go home this afternoon. So for Gabe, just for some peace and comfort for him this morning, and for Patty as well. Lord, in your mercy. Miss Barb Sanders is going to be going back in for surgery again this coming week. She had a spot right between her eyes that they fixed already. Now there's a little spot on her lip, and I made the comment to her. She said, I don't know what they're going to do. And I said, well, maybe they will sew your mouth together and you won't be able to talk. Wait, don't laugh yet. And her response was, oh, Otis would love that. So for Barb and for the doctors as they work tomorrow, Lord, in your mercy. And I actually have two unspoken requests this morning. One is not so good, but one is a very positive thing. So remember that sometimes things are just too personal, too private to say aloud, but God already knows what those prayers are. So for the two unspoken requests this morning, Lord, in your mercy. Trudy just reminded me, let me think how this works. Our brother-in-law's sister-in-law, your sister, Trudy's sister's sister-in-law, if that makes more sense. Okay. She has been diagnosed with a very rapidly growing tumor in her abdomen, and they're not exactly sure what it is. And so she has an upcoming appointment with an oncology surgeon, but they're still just not, they live in Wichita, by the way, and they are still just not sure what they're going to do. So her name is Yvonne Adamson. So for Yvonne and for her family, Lord, in your mercy. I always like to end things on a good note. When things happen like happened with Gabe, you know, Gabe is such an important part of our morning worship with the music and everything. It's like, okay, so where do we go from here? And Lavella, it is so incredible that you just are always ready to step in and do whatever needs to be done to fill those voids. And Leona, and you've got Bob to sit on the front row. How did you do that? So it really amazes me how here in this church, our church family, and I really do believe you are a family, that when something happens to one, we all come together and we make sure things work. So God is good
all the time.
Join me as we go to prayer. Kind and loving Lord, we do thank you for this beautiful morning that you have given us to come together to share our joys and our concerns with each other and especially with you. Gracious God, you've heard our prayers. We lifted each person mentioned up to you. We place them in your care. We thank you so much for your presence here with us today as we take a look at this incredible passage from John's Gospel about what it means to truly be a good shepherd. Help us to learn and to listen, and to take what we learn outside these walls to a world that is in such desperate need of that good shepherd that we find in Jesus. We humbly ask these things now in your Son's most holy name. Amen.
Will the deacons please come forward? I was reading an article, a couple of articles this past week, and talking about the divisiveness in our country, our world, and even some families. I read an article, well, one thing was comparing today with 50 years ago to see where we were. And then I heard somebody else, one of the politicians, say, are you better off today than you were 4 years ago? And I remembered an article I read. It kind of brings this together. If you could fit the entire population of the world into a village consisting of 100 people, maintaining the proportions of all the people living on Earth, that village would include 57 Asians, 21 Europeans, 14 Americans, North, Central, and South America, and 8 Africans. There would be 52 women and 48 men, 30 Caucasians, 70 non-Caucasians, or 30 Caucasians, 70 non-Caucasians, 30 Christians, 70 non-Christians, 89 heterosexuals, 11 homosexuals. Six people would possess 59% of the wealth, and they would all come from the U.S. 80 would live in poverty, 70 would be illiterate, 50 would suffer from hunger and malnutrition, one would be dying, one would be just born, one would own a computer, and one would have a college degree. If we looked at the world this way, the need for acceptance and understanding is obvious. If you woke up this morning in good health, you have more luck than a million people who will not live through the week. If you've never experienced the horror of war, the solitude of prison, the pain of torture, and not close to the death from starvation, then you're better off than 500 million people. If you can go to your place of worship without fear that someone will assault or kill you, then you're luckier than 300 million people. If you have a full fridge, clothes on your back, a roof over your head, and a place to sleep, you are wealthier than 75% of the world's population. If you currently have money in the bank, in your wallet, and a few coins in your purse, you are one of eight of the privileged few amongst the 100 people in that village. Something to think about, all the blessings that we have that really all come from the Lord. Let's remember that as we take our morning offering.
Thank you.
Gracious God, we thank you for gifts given this morning from our hearts. Help us, your children, to use these gifts to truly be a servant to people who are in need. Bless both the gift and the giver. In Jesus' holy name, amen. The choir is not singing today.
You're stuck with us. Yeah, you can hear me.
Oh, you can hear Trudy?
Yeah.
Can you not hear me good enough? Okay, good. We kicked around several different songs last night about what to do, and we finally came up with one that I've wanted to do for quite a while. How many of you realize that there is a verse to the little chorus, Something Beautiful? There is. Okay. So hopefully you will hear that today. So just remember that no matter what you do, no matter where you go, no matter how messed up you think your life is, if you turn it over to Christ, he can take something that is what you might think is worthless and turn it into something really beautiful.
Something beautiful, something good, all my confusion he understood. All I had to offer him was brokenness and strife, but he made something beautiful of my life. If there ever were dreams
that were lofty and noble, they were my dreams from the start. And my hopes for life's best were the hopes that I harbored deep down in my heart. But my hope turned to ashes, my castles all crumbled, my fortunes turned to loss. So I wrapped them all in the rags of my life and laid him at the cross. And he made something beautiful, something good, all my confusion he understood. All I had to offer him was brokenness and strife, but he made something beautiful of my life, and he'll make something beautiful of your life.
A reading from the Holy Gospel according to John. Glory to you, O Lord. I am the good shepherd. The good shepherd lays down his life for the sheep. The hired hand, who is not the shepherd and does not own the sheep, sees the wolf coming and leaves the sheep and runs away. And the wolf snatches them and scatters them. The hired hand runs away because a hired hand does not care for the sheep. I am the good shepherd. I know my own, and my own know me, just as the Father knows me, and I know the Father. And I lay down my life for the sheep. I have other sheep that do not belong to this fold. I must bring them also, and they will listen to my voice. So there will be one flock, one shepherd. For this reason, the Father loves me, because I lay down my life in order to take it up again. No one takes it from me, but I lay it down of my own accord. I have power to lay it down, and I have power to take it up again. I have received this command from my Father. The Gospel of the Lord. Praise to you, Lord Jesus Christ.
Would you pray with me? Gracious God, may the words of my mouth, the meditations of my heart be holy and acceptable to you. O Lord, my strength and my redeemer. Amen. So what makes a Christian different from other religions? We attend church on Sunday, or at least we have church on Sunday. Attendance is a choice. We believe that the Bible is God's holy word. We believe in baptism. As members of the Christian Church, Disciples of Christ, we even have our own logo, a red chalice with a white cross of St. Andrew's on it. And the chalice becomes the center of our communion table each Sunday and on special occasions. As Christians, I would suggest that we need to renew our focus on what makes our brand unique, saying what Jesus said and doing what Jesus did. If you remember when I first came here almost 8 years ago, I shared a little saying with you that I came up with when I was in seminary working on my Master of Divinity degree. That saying is SASD, stop asking. Stop asking what would Jesus do and start doing what Jesus did. There are so many movies these days that have not focused on people or even events, but on brand name products. Just recently, the blockbuster movie Barbie. How many of you saw that movie? Anybody? You did? I mean, kids would, yeah. Oh, you went to see it? Good for you. That was most popular during the summer of 2023, followed closely by the Super Mario Brothers movie, another movie based on a product. And just after 2 months, Barbie had just surpassed all box office hopes, not to mention the merchandise that was sold. One movie critic wrote that it's a child's film made for adults, done in a thoughtful and loving way. I don't know, because I did not go see that movie. Watching the film was like finding an old doll in your parents' house and discovering that it had a message for you. However, Barbie and Super Mario movies are not alone. Theaters and streaming services have also been featuring the movie Air, or Tetris, or Blackberry, or Flaming Hot. How many of you ever heard that movie? I'll get to it in a second. According to the New York Times Magazine, the movie Air told the story of Nike's game-changing sponsorship with Michael Jordan and the world-conquering shoes that emerged from it. The film Tetris did the same for an old video game, and Blackberry gave the history of a Canadian tech company whose cell phone went extinct. How many of you had Blackberries before? I did. I had one. Flaming Hot, believe it or not, was a drama about the creator of the spicy red Cheetos snack. Can you believe they made a movie about Cheetos? Who knew? You can watch the video on YouTube titled What You Should Know Before Eating Flaming Hot Cheetos. One rapper claims he was hospitalized from eating too many of those flaming hot little things. Why didn't he just stop? That caused some schools to ban them from being sold in the school's vending machines. Flaming hot, both a movie and widely popular snack food. Who knew? Future products based on movies will focus on American Girls dolls, Barney, Hot Wheels, Magic 8 Ball, Rock'em Sock'em Robots, and Thomas the Train Engine, and the card game Uno. It seems that people are drawn to these movies because they trust the brands that they are portraying. Children grew up loving Barbies. Aaron still has at least three Barbies that are still in the box that they came in. Super Mario has been played by kids and adults alike the world over, and Air Jordans were worn by teenagers to idolize Michael Jordan. Flaming Hot Cheetos, well, I'll leave that one to y'all since I can't tolerate spicy food. And according to a recent study, 46% of Gen Zers say they love Flaming Hot Cheetos. That's brand loyalty. Sadly for the church in the United States today, the Christian brand is suffering. COVID-19 prevented people from gathering to worship. Well, in most places, it didn't here, but in most places. After the epidemic calmed down, many people, especially Gen Zers, never came back to church. I've shared with you before that my twin brother has a church in Florida. In Fort Walton Beach. He's not really my twin. We just joke about that. There was a lady there that kept getting us confused, and Roger Pedro, we share the same first name. That's about it. Roger's about this young man's height sitting right down here, and he has about as much hair as he does, too. And I have a full beard and longer hair, and this lady just kept getting us confused, and I said, well, we are identical twins, you know. But they basically... Roger had to go to part-time because nobody came, not nobody, less than half his congregation came back after COVID-19. Church membership has just fallen below 50% for the very first time. According to CNN, a cascade of headlines in recent years have stained the church's reputation, including the sex abuse scandals in both the Roman Catholic Church and the Southern Baptist Convention. I think maybe it's time to improve the Christian image and brand, and we can begin right here. So where do we begin with such a daunting task? I remember a book from my first seminary class titled Bird by Bird, written by a lady named Annie Lamott. It's an incredible book. In that book, Annie's brother was in high school, and he had a paper due about birds, several different species of birds. Like I was when I was in school, he had waited till the last minute to start work on that paper, doing his research. So he went to his dad and said, how in the world am I going to get this assignment done in such a short period of time? Dad's response to his son was the title of the book that we were assigned to read. When Dad said, we are just going to take this bird by bird. That's the way we can tackle the task of getting Jesus back into the center of the life of the church, just one step at a time. And it all begins with Jesus. And truth be known, it all ends with Jesus as well. For Christians, Jesus is at the center of our faith, or at least Jesus had better be at the center of our faith. The place to begin here is to focus on Jesus, and especially his ministry and his mission. While fewer than 50% of Americans have membership in the church today, a recent Episcopal Church poll revealed that a full 86% of those polled consider Jesus to be an important spiritual figure. We need to align with the Jesus brand, meaning that we need to be the church that acts like Jesus. We need to stop asking, what would Jesus do, and start doing what Jesus did. If you hadn't noticed that, by the way, that's printed on the bottom of our bulletin every week. Jesus reveals his personal brand in the 10th chapter of the Gospel of John, as the gospel writer writes, "I am the good shepherd," using images from the Middle East. Jesus understood himself to be the shepherd of the 23rd Psalm, responsible for giving water, food, and protection to his flock. Then he takes it a step further than we might expect by writing, "The good shepherd lays down his life for the sheep," from verse 11. That's a little shocking now, isn't it? How many shepherds would really lay down their life for their sheep? I don't imagine not many. Oh, they work hard. They lose sleep. They even fight for their sheep. But to lay down their lives? No, that would be the mark of a true sacrificial shepherd, which is exactly what Jesus was. Jesus then compares himself to a more typical caretaker of a flock. Jesus says, "The hired hand who is not the shepherd and does not own the sheep sees the wolf coming and leaves the sheep and runs away, and the wolf snatches them and scatters them." We can understand the reaction of the hired hand. He is like so many of us in the workplace today, willing to follow job description and get the job done, but to go the extra mile, well, the response is often, "That's not my job." I have heard that more than one time come from girls down in the Child Development Center, and our new director is quick to correct them by saying, "It is your job. It is your job." But Jesus is a different kind of caretaker. He is committed to the Good Shepherd brand, lock, stock, and barrel. What would it mean for the church today to act like Jesus? We would have to make some, dare I say that word, changes. In the Barbie movie, which, by the way, like I said earlier, I did not see, Barbie says, "We fixed everything in the real world so that all women are happy and powerful." Really? I don't think that's the way it really is. So, in reality, that's never happened. But as the church, we do need to make changes to be in line with the Good Shepherd brand, beginning with the focus on personal relationships. For too long, the church has been transactional, inviting people to join the church so we can fill the pews, put money in the offering plate so we can all get a pay raise, and volunteer for activities. But the Jesus brand demands a focus on relationships between people and Jesus, people and God, people and one another. "I am the good shepherd. I know my own and my own know me, just as the Father knows me and I know the Father," says Jesus in verses 14 and 15. Jesus does not simply know about us. Listen closely. He knows everything about us. He knows us personally, and he loves us anyway. At the heart of the Christian faith is a web of relationships. Jesus knowing people, people knowing Jesus, all knowing God, and then really getting to know each other. I can give you an example of how one church I was involved with failed miserably at that final step of getting to know each other. Back in the late 1980s, Charleston Heights Baptist Church was one of the most successful churches in the Charleston area. I was on the staff there. The sanctuary there seated over 1,000 people, and it was full almost every Sunday. We broadcast our Sunday morning services live on the local TV stations. We had a private school that went from pre-K through 12th grade, complete with girls and boys athletic programs. Our youth group was very large and active. And listen to this, we bussed in over 400 children every Sunday from the community around. We led all the Southern Baptist churches in the Charleston area in baptisms for several years. Today, that church no longer exists. I have taken Trudy by to see the building The building's still there. It looks just exactly like that picture. But there's another church housed there now, not even a Southern Baptist church. The reason? Simply this. We fail miserably at assimilation, at getting all those that were baptized into part of the larger family that was church. And looking back, it seemed to me that the only thing that was important was getting people baptized and being able to brag about the number of people that were baptized every year. That would be like having babies and then doing absolutely nothing to help them mature into children, younger adults, and then older adults. One of the greatest gifts that the church can give the world is the gift of community, of being a family and being in community, not only with each other, but with the people outside these walls. At a time when loneliness and isolation are reaching epidemic proportions, a congregation can connect with people in life-giving ways. Just a couple of weeks ago, a terrible tragedy took place in Olathe when a young father took the life of his son and his wife and then killed himself. I wonder what could have made a difference, what could have prevented him from doing something like he did. That was a terrible thing. Where was the community involved in that? Columnist E.J. Dionne, Jr., writing for the Washington Post, wrote, "Over the past several months, an old truth has become new again. Houses of worship and other religious institutions play an essential role in promoting social connectedness, mutual aid, and community building. What has brought this realization to life is widespread concern over the rise of loneliness and the decline of forces that pull communities together, with religious disaffiliation soaring, especially among younger Americans, there is reason to worry that secular alternatives are not growing fast enough to fill the void." I would say to you that the churches are not doing their job fast enough to fill that void. But he is spot on. Congregations can overcome isolation and loneliness, provide regular social contact, serve as a community support, provide meaning and purpose, encourages service and sacrifice, and motivate people to take action to improve the world around them. That would be the Good Shepherd brand. I do understand that we do several things here in this church to help this community, to reach outside these walls. But could we do more? Or could we involve more people in what we're already doing? Take First Friday, for example. I have noticed that over the past couple of years, the people that are workers have steadily declined. Yes, I know that some people have died, but where are the people to replace them? First Friday is a time when we reach outside these walls to the community, and we could really use more help. I'm sure the same holds true for Crosslines and the Mission Food Pantry as well. There's always room for more. Back to Barbie just for a moment. At one point in the movie, a wise woman tells Barbie an important truth. Humans have only one ending. Ideas last forever. Humans have only one ending. We will all die unless the second coming happens before we do die. But ideas live forever. She is spot on, and at the heart of the Christian faith is the Good Shepherd idea. That's an idea that should live forever. Now, this morning, stop asking, what would Jesus do? And start doing what Jesus did. And there is a place for each one of you sitting here this morning or listening at home. So, let's get to work. May it be so. Would you pray with me? Gracious God, help us to see in this passage of Scripture that we are expected to become the Good Shepherd in your absence until you come again. Show us the ways that you would have us to go to better serve this community in love and fellowship. Amen.
Let's join together now in singing hymn number 411. And please know that everyone here is welcome to come to God's table this morning.
Are familiar with the playwright O. Henry, who penned this phrase in the 19th century, quote, "She plucked from my lapel the invisible strand of lint, the universal act of a woman to proclaim ownership." The gestures of a wife brushing lint from her husband's lapel, or a parent fixing a wayward curl before a young daughter's first formal dance, or smoothing the hair and fixing a crooked tie for a son's confirmation, are all familiar to us. You've seen me straighten Roger's clergy stole sometimes when it gets crooked and uneven. Sometimes the tiniest gestures contain within them meanings of great importance, which require no words to be understood. And so it is with communion. It seems a simple thing, but it proclaims several things about you of great importance. You claim Jesus Christ as both Savior and Lord. Taking communion proclaims these things: the death of Christ for the sins of mankind, every one of us. We proclaim that we are sinners, and by definition, we need the grace of God. We also tell the world that Jesus rose from the grave. He was resurrected, just as we will be one day. Our participation in communion also proclaims to the world that we are obedient Christians, for our Lord commanded that we partake of the Lord's Supper. Proclaiming Jesus as Lord tells the world that we live under His grace, forgiving and being forgiven. Our lives are not ones of vengeance, but ones of mercy. And we all have access to the throne of grace where we have been granted the privilege of eternal life with Christ. Taken just on its face, communion seems a small thing. It takes a very small portion of the time of our worship service and an even smaller portion of the words spoken. But like removing that tiny piece of lint or fixing that crooked tie, it tells the world, Jesus is mine and I am His. We say that every time we take this bread and cup. Shall we pray?
Dear God, we are members of your family gathered in this sanctuary, surrounded by the familiar faces of people we know and love. As we come to your table, we rejoice in the sense of being a family, of breaking bread together. Yet we need the aid of your Spirit to help us realize that your family goes beyond these walls. When we break bread and drink of the cup, we also do so with people from every nation, from all tribes, peoples, and tongues who are one in Christ. Help us be sensitive to their needs, their hopes, their fears, even as we are to one another. In the name of the risen Christ, who calls us to be one, amen.
We are the Christian Church, Disciples of Christ, a movement for wholeness in a fragmented world. As part of the one body of Christ, all are welcome at the Lord's table, as God has welcomed us. For it was on that night so long ago when Jesus gave himself up for you, for me. He took bread, he blessed it, he broke it. He said, "This is my body broken for you. Do this in remembrance of me." After the meal, he took the cup. It would have been the third cup, the cup of redemption. He said, "This is the cup of the new covenant, my blood poured out just for you. Drink from it, all of you. For as often as we eat this bread and we drink this cup, we proclaim his death until he comes once again."
Thank you.
Would you join me in our prayer of dedication? Oh God, by coming to your table, we receive more gifts than we deserve. You may be here this morning having never accepted Christ as your Savior. You may be here seeking a new church home. I would invite you to come as we stand and sing our hymn of dedication, Savior, Like a Shepherd, Lead Us, page 558. We'll sing the first verse. Men, don't forget, we will meet at Ron's, that's on 87th Street, on Tuesday morning at 9 o'clock for breakfast. So, yeah, go ahead. You probably do.
I would just like to thank everyone in the congregation for prayers from my family and for Bob's family. My brother has decided not to have the surgery and just monitor his aorta for the time being. My second brother, who's having the surgery, is having it Tuesday morning. And he'd been monitoring his for some years since Leland had his aneurysm anyway, so he's right on top of it. So I pray that that surgery will go well. Shelley, Bob's niece, has come home from Phoenix, and she came home last weekend, and she's constantly in a neck brace and a body brace, and it requires a lot of care. She's going to have those braces on for several weeks as she heals. So continued prayer for her, if you think of her, would appreciate that.
Good. Great. Good. Let's close in prayer. Gracious God, we do thank you for this time that you've given us to come together and look at this incredible passage of Scripture that shows us that we are to be the Good Shepherd just as you were. Help us to find better ways to serve you right here, right now. Watch over us now as we part and go our separate ways. Keep us safe above all this week. Help each one of us to live our lives in such a way that other people would truly see you and us. And all God's people said,
amen.